who's caught the dog handler in the thing. What's different about a beard? He gets the phone call from Mike, but Stan's real freaked out because he can't promise he'll make it back to Jerry. He leaves his wife to go upstairs and run a bath, and yep, you guessed it, Match cut his way back to 1960. The Lucky Seven are practicing with a slingshot, shooting at cans and glass bottles in a creek, because that's what kids did before they had hyper-realistic first-person shooters. They all suck at it, except Bev. Shoots a perfect 10 out of 10, and his thumb doesn't break the car. Inside the sewer, Henry launches a plan that involves Vic going off by himself to corral the kids into an ambush by Henry and Belch. This doesn't work out so great for Vic, though, because a super bright light starts moving underneath the floor towards where he's standing, eventually popping out of the grate, coming at him for another POV kill, all up in his face with them bright lights, kind of like a cop waving a flashlight in a drunk driver's face. The kids venture deeper into the sewer, only to have Stan get grabbed by Henry and Belch, who reminds him what his name is.
It gets me every time.
Henry takes his knife and starts picking off Stan's button, but before he can get Super Psycho Murder Greaser on it, that bright light be coming down the pike again, and it's headed straight towards those kids. Oh shit! It bursts out of the pike, knocking away Henry and Stan, and sucking up Belch back into the pike. Belch gets folded in half and pulled into the pike for a bumper, yet still pretty fury kill. Fourth in the movie, and the first to be kind of actually on screen. The light comes back and pops out of the pike to say hello to the boys again, but Stan's part of the GTFO while Henry takes their gun back. We don't get to see what he does, or whatever it is. TMNT flow with some sick LEDs on. After it passes over them, the fog plays the same. I love this fog, see it all. And then all the kids start saying things that scare them, like the road that George is for Barry, a piece of copper bars for Beverly, and some manicured werewolf claws for Richie. Stan tries to find his center by repeating the Scout Oath to himself a whole bunch of times, but that doesn't stop Pennywise from appearing out of nowhere and kidnapping poor Stan away from the group. He tells Stan to be afraid. Last up, threat to kill him, because, as he says, he's eternal and the eater of worlds. Right as he goes to nom down on Stan, though, Eddie steps up to the plate to be a hero. And even makes it real, so Pennywise's face starts melting off, and Bev takes a one shot. Not missed a chance to blow Bev, she doesn't. She hits him in the head, causing a bright light to shine. But before she can get on the second shot for a confirmed kill, Pennywise flips up the way to Frida, hopping straight into a drain with a special effect that doesn't quite hold up. Sorry, excuse it. Bill grabs his hand in an attempt to keep him from escaping, but the hand becomes a claw, and Pennywise gets away. The kids have no choice but to hope that they did enough damage to kill it, so they leave despite Drake's desire to follow. Outside the sewer, Bill makes them all swear an oath. One by one, the kids all put their hands in and swear allegiance. Stan takes a while, and he's the last to do so. Stan's really not coping with this whole thing that well, guys. A point that's proven when we jump back to 1990, and his wife comes upstairs to find him in the bathtub with his whiskey. Stan has killed himself, so he's too terrified and unwilling to face Pennywise once more. He leaves a bloody note on the wall, and part one of it reads with his wife screaming name. Welcome to the Kill Count, where we tally up the victims in all our favorite horror movies. I'm James Jason Peace, and today we're continuing our look at the miniseries version of Stephen King's It. The series was aired in two parts on ABC in 1990, and similarly, I had to make my Kill Count coverage a two-parter because there's just too much damn story to tell. If you need to watch part one, where five people have died so far, hit the bubble in the upper right corner of this video to check it out. Otherwise, let's jump straight back into the kills. Part 2 begins with Bill and his whack-ass ponytail arriving back home with Barry Maine. He visits his little brother's tombstone and gets his warning session interrupted by Pennywise digging some graves. There's seven of them, but one of them's killed. It's Bill tells Pennywise he's not afraid of him. Not very convincingly, he heads to the library where he and Mike reunite with a solid-looking man. Bill admits that he doesn't really remember anything, and if you haven't noticed, none of them really do except for Mike, probably because he never left there. Mike says he has something that'll help jog Bill's memory, and it's his old bike silver. He'll fix it up and then have a grown-ass man riding a bicycle montage, complete with such hits as being Peter Potter up and down and the Four Fighters Special. It's a sweet montage, I guess, but I'm more than happy when it comes on a creepy note after they spill cards on the ground and see Pennywise on the back. Next to arrive back in Barry is Richie, who's outraged by the closing of the Paramount Theater, and even more outraged at the latest film they've done. Oh, never heard of that. He gets to the library, but since Bill and Mike are out doing the work at Sundance.com, he has to sit there and wait. Pennywise waits with him, offering him a balloon for his trouble. But Pennywise, what if one balloon's not enough? If you ever find yourself having as much fun in your life as Pennywise is here, consider yourself hashtag blessed. Rich is not impressed by Pennywise's tablet stand-up, though, so he's not. Taking a nap in Tommy's bed, he has his driver pull over, so he can hike on down to the marriage and say hello to his old friend, Moldy Skeleton Guy. Growing up, MSG, you have an age to fit. Back in the taxi, he has another couple of visions. First one of Pennywise standing on the side of the road, then an ominous balloon in his head. And he pulls into town next, heads to a pharmacy, where he remembers a time from his childhood when the pharmacist revealed to him that his inhaler wasn't actually any medicine. It was just a placebo designed to make him feel better. Adult Eddie overhears the same pharmacist in the back, now an old man, and after a brief heart-to-heart, the old guy grabs his arm and gets creepy.
Get out, Jerry White, still
time. Old Eddie gets out. The last loser to arrive is the Beverly has made a visit to her old house. She finds out her dad died 5 years ago. But the old lady living there now welcomes her inside for some tea and memories. Things start getting weird fast. The old lady chugs her tea noisily, and the tea all of a sudden looks like she's been a lifetime tobacco chewer. And oh yeah, that tea is actually a cup of blood. Dad's on a strict no-blood diet, though. And while the old woman is cleaning up the broken tea cup, she turns into the freakiest looking corpse thing in this entire movie. Then starts talking like Dad's dad.
I worry about you, baby. I worry a lot.
Beth flees, and when she's safely outside the house, she looks back to see Pennywise doing his thing. Then she looks again and sees that the house is actually boarded up and abandoned. The lone balloon closes out Beth for a second. Then we unexpectedly jump out to the street, where Bill's wife is struggling with a guy involved in a movie contest. The suit tells Audrey not to mess up her career by missing the production, but she's so concerned about Bill that she ignores his advice and gives a ticket on the next main line train. Finally, time to get everyone back together. What better place than the giant crusher? Eddie and Ben are the first to arrive, and while they're hugging it out, Bill and Mike walk in, no doubt exhausted. A day of riding bikes. Richie loses his nerve when he sees them at first, but after a pep talk to himself at the bathroom mirror, he returns to them with his stick dialed up to 11.
All right, who got bombed? Who got wrinkled? How many got chewing gum wings? Beep, beep, Richie.
Finally, Bev walks in, and the guys are all shocked. Meadow drinks is a very big lady. She greets them all with hugs and kisses, and especially a sultry kiss from Bill. Damn, Bill, you got a wife, dude. Then they toast to the losers club and have, what the hell, another montage? Yeah, this one's even longer than the bike thing, and it's just Bev twisting out and looking around. They start catching up each other and the audience as the camera swings around them over and over and over and over and over again. Anyone else feel nauseous? You mention how Henry Bowers was to blame for all the missing and murdered kids back in 1960, but nobody would believe all his phone calls. Now Henry's hanging out in the psych ward down the way. A sad old man is trying to get some sleep, but he can't because the goddamn moon keeps talking to him and won't shut the hell off. Moon Pennywise tells Henry he's got work to do, that he needs to go back to Derry and finish killing all the losers there. Henry's all like, yeah, Mr. Moonclown, sounds good to me. That's why Henry goes out. The losers are finishing up their dinner with a round of fortune cookies, and their fortunes end up being way worse than the vague platitudes on Vince Trick's table. Instead, it's stuff like mud and cockroaches and freaking eyeballs and this little crap thing that looks like a Happy Meal bird. Oh, and a dead baby bird. That must be in order. The Kujik's refuge is next to the where Richie just goes on and on and on. Holy shit. If I die and go to hell, it'll be in the audience of a never-ending leaving stand-up comedy.
It's great to be back in Derry, breathing in that old Derry air.
Thank you, Richie. Yeah. The only thing that gets him to finally shut up is the news that Stan's dead. Stan's dead. Obviously, this brings the wind down, but Bill reminisces about a time he saved Stan from something scary. Apparently, one time Stan got called into a big old house by a mysterious voice, and once he was inside, the door locked behind him, and down the stairs came a mummy. Damn, man, just breaking out all the plastic boxes for this movie, huh? And apparently, Frankenstein and the creature from the Black Lagoon are in the book, too. Eddie talks about how Stan was the only one to see this true form in the sewer, and mentions something Stan told him.
He said, I looked into its dead eyes, and I wanted to be there.
When they go for a drink in Mike's workplace, they instead get a bunch of balloons that all float, and Stan's decapitated head, which grows to each one of the three returns and converts to Pennywise's voice for a big showstopping finale.
You don't want to float down here, and they all
God, I love it when he does that one. They all float down here? It's a classic. The library starts throwing all paranormal activity on the gang until they do a friendship huddle and shut that shit down. They wisely get the idea to ditch the creepy library and head someplace else for a while. Back at the psych ward, Henry gets a visit from an undead Belt, and he has a telepathic conversation with Belt. Belt is going to bust him out, so he can contract Henry out to throw the losers one by one. Gives him his old switchblade as a signing card. As Henry approaches the exit, the security guard Coon steps out to rough him on, but it steps into interview, appearing as a clown with a freaking Doberman head and knocks Coon down, killing him in the standard slow motion point of view shot that this miniseries leaned way too heavily on, but probably had to because it was a network miniseries. Now at a quaint hotel, Mike catches everyone up, reminding them of all the kids that were disappearing in 1960, and tells them that every 30 years, an evil kid goes down to Derry.
1930,
they're like a grown up who refused to acknowledge the evil. Like a teacher, and the old guy across the street from them, who was harassed by the crowd. Mike was whole half of the news. If you're curious, just look up Stephen King's Kid Gangbang. Or, you know, maybe no. Despite Mike's earlier warning to not split up, some of the guys do lose the separate when they go upstairs to grab clothes. During the separation, they get hit by evil shit, because that's what happens to Stephen King's.
Bye.